There's a lot of negative things about Soviet and Russian tanks out there, and quite frankly, this video is also going to be about the drawbacks of the Soviet T-80 main battle tank. Now, I could talk about the basic problems, which are actually widely spread amongst a lot of Soviet and Russian armored fighting vehicles, such as the depressing gun depression, the autoloader, or the horrible crew survivability. But I wanted to show you some things which you most likely don't know about yet, and therefore present to you something new. So hello and welcome, and enjoy this video. The original T-80 from 1976 had a TKN-3M pseudo binocular periscope, which was similar to the ones of the T-64 and T-72. Pseudo binocular means it has two eyepieces, but they combine into one view. By 1976, the TKN-3M was already as outdated as your grandpa's jokes. Sure, it was compact and could help aim at targets, but it wasn't stabilized and only had very basic range-finding abilities. The fact that it wasn't stabilized made it hard to identify enemy tanks or other vehicles at long distances when the tank was moving over rough terrain. This also makes it difficult to determine the range accurately. Its night vision was just barely acceptable for that time. The night vision worked in two ways, passive light intensification or active infrared. In passive mode, the TKN-3M amplified already existing light to create a clearer image. This was like squinting in the dark and hoping to see something, which worked well in very low light conditions like an overcast night with no moon or stars. In these conditions, it could identify a tank up to 400 meters away. 400 meters still isn't really a lot, but the resolution limit didn't allow for more. With more ambient light, like on starlit or moonlit nights, it could see targets further away. During dark twilight, it might see a tank silhouette up to 800 meters away, but then its low magnification became a problem. In brighter conditions than dawn or dusk, the image would be too bright and unclear. This can be problematic if it's still too dark for the commander to use his normal periscopes and too bright for him to use the night vision. For you to understand, it was like having to decide whether to wear sunglasses or night vision goggles on such a day. Now, we've covered the issue with the passive light intensification, but there's another way to see at night, active infrared, which brings its own set of problems. The active mode uses the OU-3GA2 or the OU-3GKU infrared IR spotlight. With this active IR imaging, the commander can identify targets from about 400 meters away. The big issue with using spotlights is that while they may help you spot targets, they also turn you into a glowing bullseye for your enemies from much further away. In this regard, the OU-3 design is especially flawed because it does not have an occluder. This means about half of the spotlight's light shines directly forward instead of being focused by the parabolic reflector, brightly illuminating a large portion of the tank. It's like trying to sneak through the forest at night with a flashlight taped to your head. Your visibility is limited to where you shine the light, but everyone else can see you coming from a mile away. But on the other hand, this extra light does help the driver see the ground more clearly, which slightly improves the speed control in low visibility conditions. Another problem is the low image resolution and the low magnification of the TKN-3M. The IR spotlights are not very powerful. When the OU-3 spotlight is used without the infrared filter, the TKN-3M can be used in daylight mode at night to increase the viewing distance. But this move basically lights up your tank like a Christmas tree, making it visible to everyone and their mother, so it's rarely done and only in specific situations. Overall, the TKN-3M night viewing capabilities are pretty awful compared to modern thermal imaging sights. Sure, it was an improvement over the original TKN-3 model from 1964, but by the late 1970s, it was about as advanced as a potato compared to more modern Western passive image intensifying optics. The earliest T-80s were basically modified T-64As, so they shared many features, including the TPD-249 optical coincidence rangefinder. But by 1976, this rangefinder was very outdated. It was first used on the original T-64 introduced in 1966, but by 1976, the more advanced TPD-K1 laser rangefinder sight had been developed and was already being used on the T-64B and the T-72A tanks, both introduced in that same year. This rangefinding process was inconvenient and somewhat inaccurate as well. The error margin was 3-5%. This means the range could be off by up to 200 meters at 4000 meters or 30 meters at 1000 meters, which is a lot. But to be fair, the average tank engagement distance in Europe was estimated to be 1500 meters, which made this margin somewhat acceptable. On top of that, the use of hypersonic APFSDS ammunition, which had a very flat trajectory, made this error margin kinda neglectable as well. The problem was more present with heat and HE frag ammunition, which were heavier and had worse ballistic coefficient and traveled at much lower speeds. Also, since armies started mounting long-range ATGMs on jeeps, scout cars, ILVs, and even light tanks, accurate long-distance shooting with heat and HE-frag shells became a must. In this regard, the T-80 is at a disadvantage. Another downside of optical coincidence rangefinders is that they are less accurate on camouflage targets. Targets or other targets hidden with camouflage netting and bushes can be hard to range accurately because their outlines may not be clear to the gunner. Identifying the silhouette through other visual cues takes time and requires a fairly experienced gunner. Because of these issues, the T-64A turret and fire control system were seen as almost obsolete by the time they were used in the T-80. Only a few hundred of the original 1976 models were produced. Some of these were later upgraded with the TPD-K1 sight in the early 1980s to keep up with modern technology. Looking at the TPN-14923 sight for the gunner, it has dependent stabilization in the vertical plane with 20 degrees of elevation and 5 degrees of depression. Dependent stabilization means that while the sight is technically stabilized, it relies on the vertical stabilizer of the cannon. Sounds cool, right? Well, there's a big problem. The cannon has to elevate by 3 degrees during the loading cycle to reload, but since the gunner's stabilization is connected to the cannon, the gunner basically loses sight of the target right after firing. This makes it just about impossible to see the impact of the shot and adjust the aim as needed. The commander can still see the target, but this isn't a very convenient way to operate. Stuff like this is a great way to make sure your enemies die laughing, if not from your shots. The viewfinder has 3 selectable reticle settings, one for each ammunition type. Each reticle has different ranging scales for the gunner to input range data. When using the TPN-349, gunnery is simplified to its most basic level. The range to the target is determined by comparing the target size with the sight of the chevron in the reticle. This is a basic and somewhat imprecise method of range finding, but it's still used in modern sighting systems as a fallback option when other methods fail. But for the gunner in the T-80, it's not a fallback option, it's the only option. But because of the short viewing distance, this limitation was deemed acceptable. Looking at thermal imaging, the realization that new Western thermal imaging technology was quickly surpassing the capabilities of light-intensifying night vision sights led the Soviets to conduct new research in creating similar devices to keep up. Thermal imaging was not unfamiliar to the Soviet military in the 1980s. Prototype imaging systems for tanks had already been developed and installed on a few T-80 tanks for trials by the early 80s. But even though they worked on some prototypes, problems with mass production delayed the development of thermal sights in the Soviet Union for a long time. The result was bad and embarrassing because this neglect put Soviet tank technology nearly a decade behind the West, both in terms of technology and industrial expertise. Only the T-80 UK had the Agava 2 thermal imaging system installed. The reason it was only installed on the UK variant was because of its high cost. Introducing this technology widely would not only bring problems with manufacturing it, but would have also significantly increased the already high price of the T-80 tank series. As a result, T-80 UK tanks were about as common as unicorns in the 1990s compared to the basic T-80U. So while the West was playing with high-tech thermal scopes, the Soviets were stuck playing peekaboo in the dark. But the Agava 2 thermal imaging system was not perfect either. Under the highest magnification setting, the sight can identify targets at around 2500 meters in clear weather. While the sight is overall effective at combat distances, its low resolution and small monitor size make it difficult to distinguish between targets at longer distances. Another issue was the anti-aircraft machine gun on top. In 1972, starting with the T-64A, there was a ZU-64 closed hatch type anti-aircraft installation, but this installation had some problems with the design. To fix the issue, a new anti-aircraft installation, the ZU-219, was designed for the Object 219. It was later evaluated in comparative trials in Cuba. The ZU-219 was tested alongside the established ZU-72 open hatch type installation of the T-72, as well as the experimental ZTPU-2 and ZU-62. At the end of the trials, it was recommended that all 3 Soviet main battle tanks standardize the ZU-219. But because of some questionable political reasons, the T-72 kept its flawed ZU-72 installation, while the T-64A kept its ZU-64 installation, and the ZU-219 was put on ice. After these developments, the vastly inferior ZU-80 anti-aircraft installation somehow became the final product used on the mass production models of the T-80. The ZU-80 is an open hatch type installation similar to the ZU-72, but it has a unique and also rather flawed design. Unlike the Z-72, the Z-80 anti-aircraft installation is mounted directly onto the commander's cupola instead of a separate ring, and the cupola is not motorized, so aiming must be done manually. This design has the bad effect of disrupting the balance of the cupola and therefore making it harder for the commander to rotate it, especially since he has to use the handlebars of his TKN3 periscope. This problem is worsened when the tank is moving over rough terrain. The height and length of the machine gun means the commander must counteract to turn the cupola by using a lot of force. Rotating the cupola is also very difficult when the tank is on a slope. While the Z-264 would have the same issue, it has a motorized horizontal drive that eliminates this problem. But the T-80 doesn't have that and makes it very inconvenient for the commander. T-80 tanks have been seen with a strange metal loop with track links attached to the back of the cupola. This appears to be a DIY solution to the cupola's imbalance issue, but it clearly does not address the root cause of the problem. While it functions quite well as a counterweight, it also adds more weight to the cupola. The NSBT machine gun on the T-80U is mounted on one of the three pedestals welded to the turret roof. This unique setup can be clearly seen in this picture. This unusual mounting scheme has a few small advantages, but overall it makes the machine gun less useful. The fixed installation limits the aiming sector to about 90 degrees forward and slightly to the right, which means the commander has to lean out of the hatch. This might be the most dangerous yoga pose to ever do. To aim sideways, the commander has to exit the hatch and sit on the turret roof, and therefore expose himself completely. Aiming backwards is impossible unless the machine gun is installed on the rearmost pedestal, which is impractical during combat since the machine gun itself weighs 25 kilograms. Something which sets the T-80 apart from the T-64A are the three periscopes in the upper glasses for the driver. The T-80 has those three, while the T-64A has a single large periscope and two smaller ones in the hatch. This new arrangement provided good visibility for the driver, but to fit the three periscopes, the cutout in the upper glasses armor had to be widened a lot. This larger cutout created a weakened zone in the armor, which was not ideal. The large cutout can be seen in this picture. This design flaw still causes problems for the T-80 series today. It cannot be fixed without completely redesigning the armor and the driver's area. Looking at the driver's station, there's a problem as well. There's a single dome light attached to the ceiling just behind the driver's hatch and head to provide some light to the driver. But the problem is that this light is behind the driver, which means most of the light gets blocked by the driver's head, so that he still can't see a lot. And this therefore makes finding the buttons on the control boards harder than it should be. Looking at the turret of the T-80U, there is Contact 5 armor, which offers very good protection with very high mass efficiency, meaning it provides a lot of protection without adding much weight. According to some Swedish data, the Contact 5 adds up to 63.7mm of steel. Contact 5 is claimed to reduce penetration by 20%, and older claims suggest it has an armor equivalency of 250mm of road homogeneous armor. If Contact 5 offers 250mm RHA equivalency, its mass efficiency would be nearly 5 times greater than normal steel. In another case, if it reduces the penetration of an APFSDS round with 700mm of penetration by 140mm, the mass efficiency would be 2.3 times greater. This means that Contact 5 provides significantly more protection for its weight compared to its traditional steel armor. However, everything comes at a cost. For Contact 5, its high explosive content is also its biggest drawback. It's possible for the activation of one model to set off another, which might start a chain reaction and is not ideal. So while the Contact 5 makes the tank tougher, it also turns it into a rolling fireworks display if things go wrong. The T-80's fuel consumption is also a problem. It is a fact that using gas turbine engines in tanks has sparked a lot of controversy, and much of it is justified. One of the best features of turbine engines is the excellent acceleration, but this performance comes at a very high cost. From a defensive standpoint, just sitting somewhere to ambush the enemy or wait for an attack consumes fuel almost as quickly as when the tank is moving. On the other hand, if the tank is on the offensive and involved in a breakthrough assault, this problem limits its ability to exploit a successful breach and penetrate deep behind enemy lines. This is problematic since part of Soviet military doctrine and tank design is for their tanks to penetrate deep behind enemy lines. Anyways, that was all I had to say for today's video. I hope you enjoyed it. If you think I said anything that is not right, or you think I should have added any additional information to this video, please let me know in the comments and share your knowledge. Besides that, Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.
Target destroyed!